Last June, tough action by the police broke up the peace convoy. Now a new law gives them even greater power. Will it mean peace in the South next summer?
For the last two summers, the peace of a large part of southern England has been shattered by ugly confrontations. On one hand, a group of travellers, quickly branded as hippies by the popular press, set on holding an open-air festival at Stonehenge. On the other, the forces of law and order in the shape of five local police forces determined to stop them. The first confrontation at Chalderton, ever since known as the Battle of the Beanfield, resulted in 500 arrests, many injuries, and violent scenes never before witnessed in rural Wiltshire. This year, the battle was less violent, but more prolonged. For 3 weeks, the convoy was kept on the move, and then broken up at Stoney Cross in Hampshire. 64 people were arrested, 129 vehicles impounded, and the bill for policing ran to over £1 million. The eviction of the stragglers at Stoney Cross was seen by some as giving the travellers their just deserts. Certainly, the government showed them little sympathy. The Home Secretary, Douglas Hurd, called them a band of medieval brigands, and Mrs. Thatcher hinted at tough new curbs to stop them from trespassing and from claiming social security benefits. Last summer's events may be fast fading from public memory, but they are not likely to be forgotten by those at the centre of the stage, an almost entirely new generation of travelling people who've emerged in the south of England since 1970. The question of whether they will come back next year is one that we'll be looking at in this programme, but we'll also look at the growing debate on whether such minorities can be accommodated in a democratic society. This is Bristol, a winter retreat for the veterans of Stoney Cross. For the people gathered here, who prefer to call themselves New Age travellers, it is time to reflect on the stormy past and to consider where they go from here. The lifestyle they follow began quietly enough in the early 70s, when they opted out of what they saw as an over-aggressive and materialistic society. By 1982, they became known as the Peace Convoy when they turned up at Greenham Common to demonstrate against the cruise missile base. Sid Rawl is one of the original founders. He claims that many people are still choosing to take to the road. We caught up with him in Bristol.
If you're going to have mass unemployment in the inner cities, and you've got it in Southampton and such places, then you are going to need to start opening up the countryside for people to go and live a meaningful life in the countryside. The rich have been going out there for the last 20 years. They've been selling up their inner city houses and moving out and buying the workers' cottages. All that's now happening is the unemployed, maybe the more intelligent unemployed, I don't know, but the unemployed are beginning to see, some of them, that actually the grass is greener out in the country because you can hardly find it in the city.
But most of the group are long-standing travellers who choose, for one reason or another, to drop out. Roger Skinner got himself involved with drugs in the 60s.
About 1959, I left school, became an apprentice printer, decided that didn't lead anywhere, and discovered traditional jazz and amphetamine in pill forms in the jazz clubs in London, and ran away from home, started hitchhiking around the country. It's just a way you need to be, you need to live in a certain way to be able to shut out the nonsense enough to be able to get on with what you need to do in your life.
People like Sid Rawl and Roger Skinner might have continued to follow their chosen life in relative peace and obscurity had it not have been for the free music festival set up at Stonehenge in 1974. It quickly grew, and by 1984 was attracting thousands of people, many just sampling a few days alternative living. But this was to be the last of the free festivals. The authorities had had enough. They claimed the site was being damaged, that the festival was a magnet for drug dealing and petty crime. Their action to stop the travellers getting to Stonehenge sparked off the violent scenes of 1985 and 86. Since the showdown at Stoney Cross last June, when the peace convoy was broken up, little has been heard of the travellers. Many of them turned up to face trial at Salisbury Magistrates Court, paid their fines and left. But it's now becoming clear that the campaign being waged against the convoy hasn't fizzled out. Wherever the battle-weary travellers go, they're claiming that local councils and police forces are following Mrs. Thatcher's call to make life difficult for the travellers. And there's growing evidence of continued and coordinated action across the south of England designed to reduce the risk of any further trouble next year. The strategy of the authorities is showing up in three ways. First of all, moving them on. It seems police forces, particularly in Hampshire, are moving travellers on much more than in the past. Secondly, social security officers have toughened up on travellers' claims, for example, imposing very rigorous standards of identification. Thirdly, many local councils now seem to be denying travellers access to official sites. The policy is clearly having an effect. The 20 or 30 travellers squatting under the viaduct at Bristol would prefer to camp somewhere in the country. But since June, they've repeatedly been moved on. This bus was one of the 129 impounded by the police at Stoney Cross. Since reclaiming it from the police, Dave Smith says he has been subject to almost constant harassment.
Evictions covering usually a common land or private land, or at least council land. Mass evictions taking place over whole areas of the country. In fact, you know, the entire country at once. Everybody being pushed out on the road at the same time. That's why a lot of these vehicles get described as decrepit, because simply when you're pushed to move all the time, you really can't, you know, get a lot together, so to speak.
Sid Rawl is convinced that the difficulties he and his fellow travellers are facing is part of a systematic and concerted policy initiated by the police, who are acting, he reckons, for political motives.
Maggie Thatcher herself said that anyone who makes life hard for, I think she used the word, the convoy or something, has my blessing. But in fact, what that has been interpreted in from one end of the country to the other is anyone who breaks any law to make life hard for any travellers can get away with it. It's just open season at the moment. It has now become a thing in this country where the police are now identifying ever-increasing sections of the population, generally the poor are sections of the population, as their enemy.
The travellers claim their chief persecutor is John Duke, Hampshire's chief constable. They claim he is the mastermind behind the strategy. Certainly he's taken a high profile this year in operations to neutralise what he saw as a major threat to public order. For the first time, he's been prepared to give a full interview about the police handling of the convoy, both at the time of and since the events of last June. He flatly denies that he was acting under political pressure from Mrs. Thatcher.
Well, they say the same thing about the miners' strike. They've no evidence of it, and certainly I have no evidence. In fact, the evidence I have is quite contrary to that. The interpretation of the law and the instructions on the law rest squarely with me and the police authority. And if the Home Office or government were to try to exceed that authority, I'm afraid they'd be getting the same answer from me as I would give anyone else who seeks to upset the balance of the constitutional position. And the constitutional position is very simple, that law and order and the enforcement of order lies here in Hampshire.
The huge police operation last June that finally broke up the convoy at Stoney Cross and impounded many of their vehicles was, according to the chief constable, simply an effective response to the threat posed to peace in Hampshire at that time. Certainly local farmers were demanding that the police do something about what they saw as a serious threat to their livelihood. Peter Redshaw is a leading member of the Hampshire branch of the National Farmers Union.
It was proved so this year that we were unable to control the activities of the people that arrived, that travelled here. There certainly perhaps wasn't the damage done to farmland as there was further down country and in the other counties, but we did have livestock worrying as a result of the arrival of these large numbers of people. I mean, we live in a society where we all choose to conform to a way of life, or at least 99.9% of us do, and those that wish to carry on this travelling method of life, this travelling existence, must really conform within the law, within the rules that the rest of us accept, and for that we have to support the police in carrying out the law.
But many of the travellers believe that the Hampshire police have since gone beyond merely enforcing the law. After Stoney Cross, a few of them camped at Mottisfont near Romsey, on land belonging to a sympathetic local farmer. But after 4 weeks, the police insisted that they move on, and the pattern seems to have continued ever since. Hampshire police say there's no hard and fast policy on moving the travellers on. They are simply no longer prepared to turn a blind eye to any breach of the law. But John Duke admits that the force is keeping a careful watch on travellers' movements along with other local forces.
I think we'd be doing a disservice to UK Limited if we didn't keep an eye on where they are during the sort of non-peak periods. We'd be doing a disservice to effectiveness if we didn't seek to find out who and what they are. So there's got to be monitoring. We'd also be doing a service to the system we work in UK Limited if we didn't meet from time to time the various others in Wessex, chief constables, police authorities, hopefully, to say, well, how are we going to face this problem if it does come up again?
There is evidence, however, that Hampshire police have followed a strategy designed to make life difficult for any groups of travellers inclined to stay on in the county. This is Canada Common, just off the A36 between Southampton and Salisbury. When the peace convoy was moved on from Mottisfont, it stayed here for about 3 weeks in August. The group was repeatedly charged with illegal parking and camping on the common. Eventually, the cost of the fines forced them to leave and break up.
We found one of the members of the convoy now camped just off the A31, near Den's Diner, a mobile transport cafe. Sarah Thompson is a 20-year-old who was among those evicted at Stoney Cross.
Well, you know, as we know, we can't travel in such big numbers anymore. We have to stay in very small groups, which you don't see friends who you've been used to travel with a few years ago. You probably won't see them again for a few more years, because we're just so split up all over the country. You know, that's one problem of police, because they're just cutting you down, evicting you all the time.
The police forces deny that there's any master plan to force the travellers to move on and on. They claim they're only responding to local public pressure. But there's more direct evidence of a changed attitude since last June on the part of social security officers. Until last summer, many of the travellers claimed social security benefits as unemployed people. Totten's social security office, just outside Southampton, was kept busy last summer by a constant stream of claimants. On the 9th and 10th of June, following the eviction at Stoney Cross, they handled 186 claims in just 2 days. But now the ability of travelling people to draw benefits has been, it seems, effectively curtailed. And the policy doesn't apply merely to travellers in Hampshire. Here, in the far east of Kent, just off the A291 that runs from Canterbury to Herne Bay, we found some travellers who have stayed well away from Hampshire and Wiltshire this year because they feared there might be trouble. Mes Lucerne has been camped here with her 14-year-old son, Tark, for about 4 weeks. Since the summer, she's been moved on 6 times. She's been finding it difficult to claim Social Security benefit at the local Canterbury office. She considers the DHSS officials are now being overzealous in checking her details.
The difficulty with claiming is that having to move from site to site, although your circumstances remain exactly the same, you live in the same vehicle, and obviously you haven't got laundry facilities. They insist on you completing new forms, B1s. Now this can stop your claim for a week, 2 weeks, or it may mean you have to keep going down to the offices and asking to be paid some money.
The DHSS denies that there's been any change in policy, but the complaint that there has been a clampdown on claims made by travellers is shared by many others. Sarah Thompson regularly signs on as available for employment in Southampton. She's had trouble over identification.
I had those 4 months problem because I didn't have any ID. I couldn't get hold of any, and my mum said she'd lost my birth certificate. But the Citizens Advice Bureau helped me there. I have to go to Southampton to sign on, and then I have to go to Totten to cash my gyro and come all the way back here. That's about £5. And travelling. That's messing about that they've done, you know, making us walk.
this unpublished DHSS report could lie behind what seems to be a change in policy. It's the report of a working party set up in 1985 in the wake of the beanfield battle at Chalderton. In order to prevent fraud, and in particular duplicate claims by the same person, it recommended
a stricter control on identity for traveller claimants.
Tony Viney is an education welfare officer with experience of dealing with families and their problems. He heads a group of professionals in the field who are convinced a new get-tough policy is being applied nationally.
There is evidence of increasing controls when members of the peace convoy or nomadic claimants generally try to claim benefit. And that affects both caravan dwellers and members of the peace convoy. Stricter controls over identification is one example. And a refusal to accept certain forms of identification is one measure that's being used to actually prevent them claiming benefit.
Even though the changed attitude of the police and social security officers make life significantly more difficult for the travellers, it's the third arm of the strategy that's providing the greatest controversy. Local councils are simply not permitting the travellers access to official sites. As a result, the travellers have little option but to trespass on private land. Here in Kent, Tark Lucerne and his mother have been squatting on private land for the last 4 weeks. They're only here because they were moved off a council-owned site in Canterbury.
I was brought up in Canterbury, and it's 12 years of my life, and now we're never going to be able to park up there again. They don't really have to move you on for any reason in a lot of cases, because a site we were on in Canterbury, the case for moving us off was they said that it was a case of urgency to get us off this land because they wanted to build something on it. And this was, how many months ago now?
It's 5 months ago.
Yeah, 5 months ago, and nothing's been done. It's basically a rubbish tip up there.
Although the site at Canterbury wasn't an official site, in fact, county councils are obliged by law to provide sites for travelling people. This is one of the few presently existing in the south at Sittingbourne in Kent. It's been laid aside under the Caravan Sites Act of 1968. This put a duty on councils
to secure the establishment of such sites for the use of gypsies and other persons of nomadic habit.
But since 1968, there's been very slow progress in setting up such sites. This one at Sittingbourne is classed only as temporary, although it's been here for 10 years. Inadequate as it seems, Kent County Council has ruled that a site like this is not to be used by New Age travellers, but only by gypsies. Those who have to deal with the day-to-day problems of travelling people believe the decision to exclude the New Age travellers from sites like this owes much to a strong hint dropped by the government department that oversees the Act.
The actual guidance from the Department of the Environment, some of the official guidance that I've seen actually says the hippie community are not gypsies under the Caravan Sites Act. And then with some embarrassment, they backtrack a bit on that and say it's up to every local authority to decide who are gypsies. Which is very interesting, because with most laws, it's the courts that decide it, not the local authorities or the government.
But the government is probably not responsible for the way the Act is being put into practice in Kent, to the even greater disadvantage of the travellers. Those districts that are judged to have adequate provision of sites under the Act are called designated areas. In these areas, the county council has extra power to move on people not camped on the official sites. In Kent, these powers are being used to force travellers to move off sites that are not official. At the same time, the official sites are closed to the New Age travellers. It seems they can't win. Recently, Mez and Tark have been moved by Canterbury Council on several occasions.
We know anywhere that we park, we will be given 2 days, and then the council will come along and tell us that proceedings are being taken, and we'll have to go to Magistrates Court. And then they can move us off over the border of Canterbury. And it's such an upheaval for the children, and a worry too, that we've now been forced to move away from Canterbury, from our family. And we're now living 18.5 miles away, which seems rather unfair.
Many councils in Kent are giving the travellers effectively only two options, either to move right out of the district or to move onto private land and face possible action as a trespasser. And this week, a further blow has been dealt to the travellers. the Public Order Act was finally passed by Parliament. Travellers camping on private land could be guilty of a criminal offence and face imprisonment if they refuse to move off when requested by a police officer who is acting on the complaint of the owner or tenant.
One person who'll be particularly satisfied with what can be seen as a victory for law and order is the MP for Basingstoke, Andrew Hunter. He's taken a public stand in a campaign to stop any official sites being opened in his area and is leading opposition to a proposed site near the village of Dummer. He welcomes the new act, although he thinks it doesn't go far enough.
The hallmark of our society is and should be tolerance and understanding and balancing mutual interests, sometimes potentially conflicting interests. As far as travelling persons are concerned, I think the balance is upset. We are leaning over backwards to be tolerant, and by so doing, we're actually compounding the problem. I believe that trespass should become a criminal offence, not remain a civil offence. This is the feeling of the NFU, the Country Landowners Association, and many other people. I think the law is wrong. I think we should turn trespass into a criminal offence.
The new legislation is aimed largely at groups with 12 or more vehicles, but smaller groups could face prosecution under the Act if it seems to a police officer that they've caused damage, no matter how slight, and refused to move.
We're slightly more isolated, aren't we?
Yeah, we're more isolated. I mean, where we are at the moment, I mean, we barely get any visitors. The nearest even village is 3 miles away. In an emergency or something, it's quite hard to get anywhere, you know, to, like, contact relatives or anything.
All in all, it's beginning to look as if the authorities have won almost a total victory. Even the Bristol convoy will find it difficult to stage an advance on Stonehenge next year, given that they are under police surveillance and can easily be broken up into smaller groups with the help of the new Act. But on the other hand, it doesn't look as though the long-term problem presented by the travellers is going to go away. People like Sid Rule have no intention of giving up their lifestyle.
You can't solve what is essentially a problem of homelessness, although it's gone further than that now, but what is essentially a problem of homelessness, rootlessness, you cannot solve that by a policy of harassment back into what? I mean, the question always is back into what? I have been on the road, brought up my children on the road. Where am I supposed to go back to? If anybody thinks about this for a little while, would it be any point in my going back to, what, the last place I had a house was Kentish Town? I mean, is Camden Council going to want to see me back after 12 years?
In the view of the travelling people, they have no alternative but to keep on the road. The conflict between them and society as a whole will continue to smoulder on, with much police effort and ratepayers' money being spent in moving the problem from one community into another. But some observers fear that there are other hidden costs that will have to be borne by us all. Paddy Hilliard lectures in social policy at Bristol University.
Well, what will happen is this. The police will have the power to move people on off land. And in other words, we have a criminal law of trespass for the first time. The problem with this is that it will just move people from one place to another and it won't do very much to solve the basic problem. But it's wider than that, I think, because other people are going to be caught by this new law. For example, if a group of mountaineers go out with their buses and their motorbikes to a particular site in the countryside and they park their vehicles on a private piece of land, then they're technically going to be committing an offence in certain circumstances. So a lot of people, not only New Age convoy travellers and the like, may well be caught within this new law.
For the moment, Mez and Tark Lucerne are more concerned about where they must move to next.
I'm afraid they have made it more difficult for us travellers, especially if you live in a coach. A truck, if it's got a slightly shabby exterior, and a lot of us haven't got the money to keep up the exteriors. You can pull into a town or drive past and immediately you can see the panic. And in fact, people will come up and say, oh, you're peace convoy, etc. It's an assumption. At the same time, it's quite sad because I know a good proportion of the convoy that have been with it right from the start, which was the peace convoy, which was a good movement. They were travelling for world peace. A a core of them still remain, and they're good people.
Given time and a few peaceful summers at Stonehenge, the present hostility towards the peace convoy people might subside a little. But the prospects of any lasting solution to the problem they present to society aren't good. The travellers are determined to stay on the road, claiming they have nowhere else to go. At the same time, the police authorities feel they can't surrender their responsibility to uphold the law. In the view of Hampshire's chief constable, the onus should be on the travellers to change. It seems a sure formula for continuing conflict.
The solution certainly doesn't lie with the police. It certainly doesn't apply with law, new statute. It applies with an attitude of mind about whether you are part of society, whether you are part of the tribe, or whether you're part of a new tribe that you want to opt out of the old style. And it seems to me that many of these people have made that option, but they still want their pipe, their lead, their support back into the old tribe, the conventional people. And that makes people a little cross.
Good evening from one of Amsterdam's